Welcome to Real Business of Wine, session on Europe in a very broad sense. And we have one of my best and oldest French friends, Irène Tolleret, who I have known for more years than I care to think about. And Irène will, I think, explain a little bit of how she moved, how she evolved, if you like, from being in working for some big wine companies in France to making wine, and eventually to the point at which she is now as still making wine, but also a member of the European Parliament with all sorts of quite specific areas of interest there. We also have Felicity Carter, who regular viewers will know. Felicity Carter, editor of Wine Business, Mining is Wine Business International, and whose daily role, apart from making my life more challenging by bouncing my copy back when I write copy for her, her daily life is to try to keep an eye on the world of wine, the wine industry globally, both for Mining is Wine Business International as a magazine, but also as an online platform. So Irène, you were working for some French wineries. Who were you working for back in the 1990s? You were working for...
I started working with Scali, who was the Pope of varietal wines. He created the Vin de Pays d'Oc and varietal wines from France. And he had also winery in the Napa. So I got involved in the international wine trade. And that's how I met you too.
But that he was, Scali was in the business of pasta, I think, in France. And with his brother, I think there was the family. And basically, they were the revolutionaries of Languedoc-Roussillon, in a sense. They came in and said, "We're going to make Chardonnay. We're going to make Merlot," and they brought in Michel Roland, I think, at one point. Quite a lot, and they had an art gallery, winery with an art gallery. It's a very, very Napa-based concept. And that business has been sold to Boissy, I think, in more recent
times. Yeah, it has.
So you then went from there. What happened after that?
I went to Val d'Orbieu, a very short time to Vigneron Catalan, but to Val d'Orbieu mainly. And in Val d'Orbieu, I was at a time when it was a concentration in the French wine business and cooperative business. And the French market share was shrinking all over the world. And the idea was to, instead of having regional players, it was the constitution of national or international players. It was the time when Boisset went from Burgundy to, and at the same time, Val d'Orbieu went from Languedoc to Bordeaux and Provence.
So they had Cordier as the négociant, I think, and some other things. So you were involved in trying to export those wines internationally.
And market them also.
And what was, and going back, because what's interesting to me about the history of, we'll talk about Europe generally, but in terms of French wines, there was this time of moving from Appellation wines, VDQS, and Vin de Table. And we're moving, in that period, we were moving towards the concept of Vin de Pays, and then eventually into Vin de France. How much of a shock was that to the French system, that whole evolution period?
It's still a shock in the sense that we had to tackle some issues, and we were lost on what were the key issues and what were the solutions. For instance, what was the brand? Was the brand Bordeaux or was the brand Cordier? And if we had a quality issue, was it with the brand Bordeaux or was it with the brand Cordier? And so I think we lost a lot of time because brands at that time were supposed to bring consumer loyalty and bring simplicity, whereas in fact we managed to try and build brands that we did not simplify the thing and that did not sufficiently tackle the quality issues. And I think that the brands we are talking about that are not existing anymore failed because of that. And the brands that still exist and that have sold from France are brands that manage to have a constant quality, which is not a winemaker quality?
So this is a fascinating question to me, because you understand the whole marketing and branding and so on business. France, you've got a lot of very intelligent people, you've got some good business schools, you've got some great fashion brands, you've got all sorts of brands in other areas. Why has wine, with a few exceptions, and let's take champagne out of that picture, but why has the rest of wine in France been so bad at creating really strong international high volume brands in the way that we see them in the new world?
Maybe we were not hungry enough. In Australia, if they did not manage to build a successful brands, then they would not exist. In France, with the AOC system, there was still this backup that was the collective AOC brand. And when you make consumer tests, the question when you go to your local wine cellar, you want a 499 at that time, sorry, you wanted a 499 Australian Chardonnay, or you wanted a 499 Red Bordeaux.
And in, so you're talking about in the UK, yes?
Yeah.
Yeah.
But it's what is it? The it was not. You didn't go at that time and into a shop and accept American brands, but you didn't go and say, "I want a bottle of Cordier." You wanted a bottle of Bordeaux at a certain price level. And if you remember the label, it was already a massive achievement.
And one of the things that I've heard in France as well is the French distribution, because most French wine is still sold in France. The French distributors have always been historically a block between the consumers. And so when varietal wine started to be developed in the New World, and indeed in Eastern Europe, what we had was French consumers were ready potentially to buy Chardonnay and Merlot and so on, but the French supermarkets were less ready to offer it to them. Was that a reasonable thing to say?
It of course, we are not the most adventurous markets for wine. And as we are a big producing country, we are very resist a lot to all the innovations in wine. And this is a little hindrance, because that means that it's more difficult for a French wine company to make innovation, because the home market will be less open. But things have changed. We have not innovations, but marketing disruptions that have happened in the last few years, like Rosé Piscine, which were not possible 10 years ago.
So, swimming pool, rosé, as you rosé. So you then, let's go back to your history, and we'll come back to some of these things later on, but you then decide to actually have your own domain, because your husband, Philippe, is a winemaker.
Anyway, yeah.
You decide to have your own domain in Pic-Saint-Loup, which is the most successful appellation in Languedoc, in maybe?
Yeah. Yes, because first of all, I had met my husband, so it was a time in life where maybe we wanted to build a family, things like that. But also, I must admit that I was very fed up, because I had worked for two big Languedoc companies, and we built added value, and it was always the same thing. So when you have your brand that reaches a certain level, then you must keep on investing. It's not a one forever. And it's a recipe, it's a mechanism. You need to have a levels of promotions and things like that. And in both cases, both in Scali or in Val d'Orbieu, each time a brand reached a certain level of success, then the top management was saying, let's change everything. And I think that to build consumer loyalty, the one thing you must not do if you want to build a brand is a change all the time. The consumers, they need to be able to find you. And this is true for a brand of wine, but it is true also for a brand of cars. If Mercedes didn't look like Mercedes, and if they kept changing the look of their cars each year, then nobody would buy Mercedes because we wouldn't know what the brand brings to the market.
So you know, how big is your estate? How many hectares?
It's a 9-hectare vineyard.
So it's quite small. Smallish. So how many bottles, how many bottles are you producing?
35,000 bottles.
And the price is quite premium, I think, two levels?
I have a 10 euro and 15 euro for the consumer, and if you talk in a euro. So it's not cheap, but it's not that expensive. We are not in the luxurious market. We are also, that's one of the constraints of an AOC, is that you have a price gap, and you need to put your bottles inside this price gap. Otherwise, your AOC cannot develop because for the consumer, the collective brand will not be clear.
So that's where nearby appellations like Minervois and Corbière are harder than Pic Saint-Loup, which has got a cheaper higher price. And then how do you go from being a vigneron, a little running a small estate, suddenly, what's the jump from being there to being a member of the European Parliament? What was that journey? What happened?
In fact, it's quite funny because my domain didn't have the Pic Saint-Loup AOC, so we had to do all sorts of administrative things. And so I discovered that AOC land and things like that, they were involved in local laws. And I ran for mayor of my little village and I got elected. And then as I was a woman, I was given more responsibility for agriculture in the total area. And I discovered that there were tons of European money that begged to be used. And so I put myself in charge of that. And so I got 2.5 million euro to spend locally on any project we wanted. And I did that. And as it happens, on a village nearby, we have a famous guy called Daniel Cohn-Bendit, who has his summer house. And so suddenly he was quite surprised to see his newspaper talking about Europe doing things locally. And that's how I met him. And he gave me the shock, the step up, the ladder up.
So I need to interrupt because I'm old enough to remember 1968. He was one of the big names in the riots and protests of 68. So he's a cult name in France. And what's he, is he in wine in the region?
No, not at all, just retired. In fact, Daniel Cohn-Bendit is very funny because he's both French and German. And he was elected in the European Parliament for the Greens. And he was the president of all the Green group in the European Parliament. But so in Germany, he's with the German Greens called the Grünen, Die Grünen. And in France, he supports Macron. And that's how I, basically they were looking for girls also, if I may say so. And they were interested in the fact that I think I speak English. And I'm very technical. I'm not, I think that spending money is good.
So how have you spent the money? I can't lose that bit. You had 2.5 million euros. What do you do with it?
I did fantastic things. For instance, we helped all the wine growers and farmers teach themselves to identify the biodiversity challenges that they have and work with the biodiversity. Like if you have a certain type of owls or bats, then you don't need to have insect killers because the bats will eat the insects. And also what sort of flowers are protected and what sort of all this combination that is called auxiliaire d'agriculture. And all the idea of plant protection, natural plant protection. So we did that. We did also free music and food festivals because in rural areas, What is difficult is to start a festival. And so we started one called Festapic. And so it's very thriving. We helped also develop what are called the third party places. So more and more people, maybe they will work from their home or maybe not go to the office every day. So it can be quite a good public money to spend it on little offices with coffee and things like that. And all the local people, they can go here and work. And also we equipped these with 3D printers. And so it's all also used in link with the schools. Like the children, they design their own monster, and then after they go to this place. It's called the Fab Lab, and in the Fab Lab, they explain how to go from a 2D to 3D, and then after they can print their own monster and go home. And it's so it's new places that are public, so it's free of use. And it's between a private use for company and a public use for school, but also to help innovation and local innovation. And basically, if you are a genius, that you can start your company in your village.
Felicity, you view the world of wine, and we hear a lot about EU subsidies and so on. How aware, and I'm not interested in knowing about how much money goes up, how aware are you journalistically of what happens to the money that the EU gives out in this way?
Well, what I know of it is how difficult it is to unlock. There's a company in Italy, in Milan, and its whole business is doing nothing but helping wine companies unlock EU promotional funds, because I've been told it can take one person working full-time for 3 months to actually get one of the subsidies that's earmarked for wine. So the Italians have been very, very good at this because they have a professional infrastructure of people who do nothing but unlock these funds. And that's why the Italians in particular have been very, very good at overseas advertising and overseas promotions, because the funds might be there, but I'm told they're extremely difficult to get hold of. I'd be interested to hear from Irene how difficult or easy it was to get them on.
Basically, it was damn simple, but as you can hear me, I am down to earth and I do not overcomplicate myself. So the European funds, they come with a way to use them. So I did not change one word in what we were doing in France. In France, we are the world champion to put complexity where it's not needed. If the European Union will fund basketballs, then in France, we are able to say that we fund round balls of a certain Pantone color of orange, and instead of just saying basketball. And then after, when you have your basketball, you have to prove that, not that it's a basketball, but that it's round. So what is round? What is the Pantone color? And so basically, I was quite mad when I discovered that in France, things could be simple. And in fact, the European monies we were doing, we were the only one using it in this way. And now in the region, all the people are using it in the same way. Like instead of having the people file a lot of paper before they giving them the go, we gave the go on the idea. And then with the security of the fact that they were going to get the funds, then work on the complete file with the invoice and things like that, and help them from the scratch, so that the paperwork was not too difficult. To come back on your specific point, it's also in the wine trade, it's part of it's called the CMO, Common Market Organization, and it's one of the CAP file, and it's a very complex file. But since March of 2020, because of the COVID-19 crisis, we have flexibilized everything. And now I think that one of the good things of the COVID-19 crisis is that we have stopped being nightmarish in all the complexity that you were describing and that exists.
Felicity, you were going to ask something.
I was going to say, Irene, do you think that there's money available for people to tap into that they're not aware of?
That's one of the big issues. So you have different issues. So the wine money, in fact, is co-managed. When you say common market organization, it means that in France, in Italy, everywhere, this money is managed by the member state plus the winemaker organizations. So they sit at the table, so they know very well how to use it. There is a selfishness syndrome when there is a lot of money. It's the temptation of the pot of jam. And maybe some people want to keep the jam pot for themselves. But in fact, I think that the winemakers organization are there to help all their members to use the European money, that they help to define what is going to be funded or not.
Now, Irene, the EU famously gives subsidies to help export markets outside the EU.
Yeah, that's
the money you're talking about, does any of that come down to the level of helping producers understand how to do marketing, how to do direct selling and those sort of things?
It could. At the moment, it doesn't, but it could. It's just a matter of... basically, you have... at the moment, we are working on what we call the multi-annual framework. The little name is MFF. So that's the budget for the next 7 years. Inside this negotiation, there is a big issue that is the cap money, so all the agriculture money, and this cap money is a split between what is called the first pillar, helping farmers to have a decent living, and then the second pillar, which is more rural development and investment in organic farming. Inside the first pillar, the wine have decided to work in another way, and that's the common market organization, and they can agree on everything. So that's why they can agree on yields, they can agree on specific measures, but it's really co-managed. And for instance, we have this big surplus, and this year it was decided to authorize a distillation crisis. So what this money is used for is co-managed. So what is not spent today in a certain line could be spent tomorrow. But marketing better on the markets, I think there is no problem for that.
Now, one of the criticisms that's made of the EU, and certainly in the UK with Brexit and so on, is that it interferes too much and there are too many controls and so on. Now, one of the things we've been hearing about is ingredient listing, that we're going to have to put on labels what is in the wine. It's not being talked about, it hasn't been talked about very much, but it's beginning now to be talked about. Can you say anything about that?
Yeah, I think that Brexit is the biggest fib story I have ever heard in my life. So of course, there is a consumer and citizen pool to know what they are eating and drinking. But because of the common market organization, wines and spirits are not part of that. So there is a real subject on allergens. And so this is why now on the label, we have a certain level on of allergen like SO2, but not the exact figures. And on the we are currently working on the future of this text. And the solution that everybody agrees on is to have a QR code that would make a link to the traceability that winemakers do. That way, we are sure to always follow the law and consumer can know exactly what are the ingredients.
And when we say ingredients, I'm sure other people are going to ask this question. obviously, and you're a winemaker, so you understand if you're fining with egg white, the egg white in theory is not in the wine, or if you're doing Benton. Where do we start and where do we stop in terms of our, do we put residual sugar? Do we put whether we have added the sugar or not? Where is it going to start and stop?
Sorry for my phone. Basically, we put what we want. So, as you know, wine is made with grape, but because of the AOCs and all the names that are used in wine, on the ingredient list, we do not need to say that we use grapes. But then, what is compulsory is to put the level of alcohol, and SO2 and sulfur dioxide, and depending on some markets, we have, and that is an issue, different demands arriving. And it's a very big issue, because if all member states or all markets decide to have different laws on the label, it's going to be very, very, very complicated for the people who sell, and it will create job losses to cut a long story short. So it's a massive issue that we keep the common market common, and that's why we are working on. I must admit that with OIV and things like that, there are discussions between European wine producers, American wine producers, and I am confident that we will manage to have the same solution for everybody.
Polly, you had a question.
This is a jump from what we've been talking about with wine, but one of the things when Robert told me we were interviewing you and I went in and started poking around is that you have a very pronounced focus on gender issues, equality issues, LGBTQ. Yeah. And of course, right now around the world, we're dealing with this in a very pronounced way, but wine has always had has issues with acceptance nonconformity. Can you talk a little bit about the intersection of these two things that you love, you know, wine and issues of gender equality and diversity?
Yeah, funnily enough, I discovered these issues when I arrived in the European Parliament, and I was asked if I was okay to take charge of that. And in fact, I discovered that some people suffered, and so of course I think it's very normal that we have a diverse society, and that it brings a life. It's better to live in a society, I think, that is inclusive of all the richness that everybody can bring. And at the moment, I think that we do have a serious problem, but not the same problems at the same place at the same time. I think we all share in a lot of countries an issue on black people. Nobody says I'm racist. But then in the end, when you look, people with a black skin have a less chance to have high position and things like that. And I discovered the importance of the symbolic issues. And I think that the wine trade could do better. We have done quite well on women. We have some women winemakers. We have Gina Gallo. So we had Lalou Bizleroy. So we have a very strong and recognized women in the wine trade. I'm not so sure that we have so many black men all over the place, or aborigines, or be it in South Africa, in Australia, or in America. So it's a weakness of the wine trade, because we sell, if we don't represent a drink that is inclusive, then we can be cornered in a certain place of society. We could become, a white male over 50 drink. And what is our future if we are cornered in such a place? So I think it's high time that he also in the wine trade, we tackle the subject of inclusion but in a nice and simple manner, not just realizing it is already getting the way to the solution, I think.
So Felicity, you keep an eye on these issues, and particularly the issue of gender in wine. Irène is painting a picture as if the female issue has been, if I can put it that way, but if the fact the male-female balance in wine is not as bad as it was, that there are some high-profile women in wine. I question that a little bit in the sense that I think Gina Gallo is of the Gallo family, and quite a lot of the prominent women in wine seem to be of family. What do you see?
Okay, so what you're talking about is actually something called the alpha fallacy, which is that you can't assume that an organization or a country has gender parity because there's somebody at the top. So the fact that, you know, you've got top people doesn't always, what you're looking for gender parity is how well things are throughout a whole organization. Are you seeing people at all levels? And we did an international survey 4 or 5 years ago about what women were finding in the world generally. And you find in Europe, there's a lot of involved in wine, but they tend to have inherited and married into it rather than they've got jobs. So in many countries, it's still, particularly the Mediterranean countries, it's still quite difficult for women to get jobs as winemakers or get pay parity. We know in countries like Australia and New Zealand where women have been involved in viticulture that they often have to exit the industry if they have children. We know that women are about 57% of wine consumers, but are still excluded from discussions of the fine wine system. What is interesting at the time is we're seeing a historic shift at the moment. We're seeing a lot of really important wineries passing from one generation to another, and for the first time in history, those are being inherited by daughters, and that has never happened before at any point in history. And now we're having it happen en masse. So we're seeing a feminization of the industry just from inheritance issues. What that means for the future is will be really interesting. Personally, I think what we need is we need more women involved in finance and logistics. We tend to talk a lot about winemaking, but actually, it's where the finance and logistics is where the power and the money is, and we still don't see enough women involved in those areas.
Irène, so you've now moved from being mayor of your village to being in the European Parliament. What are the main issues? Now, sitting in the UK, it would be very easy for me to imagine that the thing that's exciting you most in Europe is losing the UK. On the other hand, you could argue that the thing that's exciting you most at the moment might be the 25% tariff that we already have in America and the threat of 100% tariff. Or we could be saying it's coronavirus, or we could be saying it is climate change or something else. What are the main issues that when you're dealing with the Parliament are really at the top of your agenda?
The Brexit issue is not my choice, and I deeply regret it. But however, we cannot wait for the UK to, because we have to prepare ourselves. And yesterday, the day before, we did an intergroup on exactly how many customs officers do we need to hire, and how are we going to deal with the northern border? I mean, we lose a lot of time. At the moment, I have three main areas that really interest me. Of course, the climate change is there for every one of us inside the European Parliament. So we have to get things moving on that. Then also, because of the lessons of the COVID-19, we have this massive recovery plan. And so now I count in billions, and we really are making Zooms all over the place to try and make sure that the recovery plan billions are available on the 1st of January 2021, and that the projects that need to be funded are already being defined when we talk today, so that we can make this new deal and the recovery for the economy. I think that the third challenge that we will have is the retraction of the global market. It was as if in the 80s, we discovered the globalization through exchange of local products. And then after we had global brands, and globalization became the same culture sold all over the place, be it through brands or culture, and a movement of goods all over the place, even on goods that before were not moving. I must admit that I think that these days are past. We work on what we call sovereignty, because of the COVID-19 crisis, when all the transport stopped, there was the issue of food, not only wine. Huh? And so I'm not sure that the international market will have the same energy as before, and that it will rebuild itself.
And back on that subject, obviously the tariffs are a major issue because we already have a 25%. That's not necessarily going away. And I think in August, we have the threat, the discussion. What do you see happening?
First of all, I'm very close to that subject because I am the co-chair of the intergroup on wine, spirits, and quality foodstuffs of the European Parliament. So all the MEPs that touch cheese, olive oil, parmesan, whiskey, wine, cider, we all get together, and I'm a co-chair of that. So as soon as the Trump tariff started, we asked for a solution. And in fact, we almost had the solution, but the COVID-19 crisis starts. We did work with the American caucus. So inside the parliament, there is in the Congress, in the American Congress, they have also a group of Senate in the Senate or congressmen that also are nearer to the wine trade. And so we did a joint statements. Also, we discussed with the American wine importers, restaurant organization in the US. And in fact, at the moment, the figures are very, very stark clear. The US lost more jobs because of the tariff than the European wine producers. So at the moment, in February, there was, end of January, sorry, there was the possibility to get to the 100% tariff, but all the congressmen said, are you crazy? We don't want to lose more jobs. And I think in August, of course, it's Donald Trump. He's going to say, I'm not okay with the European project to put a tax on internet companies. But I'm not sure that he will go for the 100% tariff, because even the American internet companies, and we do have also Chinese internet companies that are very big, they now all agree with the fact that they need to pay more taxes in one of their first consumer markets, that is the European Union. And we just want to...
But do you think the 25? So we've got two things. What you're saying is you're sounding optimistic about the 100%.
Yeah.
But then again, Trump could still make that a 10% or a 20% or a different tariff. But let's say that is not happening. We still have the 25% tariff based on the Airbus subsidies. Are we expecting that to be here for the future, assuming Trump were reelected? In any case, do we think that that's something that Europe, or not all of Europe, of course, but the European countries involved are going to have to go on living with?
Yeah. Alors, in fact, on the Airbus and Boeing thing, the US were the first to attack, but there is a mirror legal action on Trump attacked Europe on Airbus, but Europe attacked the US on Boeing. And so we are waiting for the Boeing statement. And most probably it should be 4 billion euro of taxes against the US. So and the people that are in charge of the trade in the European Union, they know, and with their American contacts, that the 20% tax will stop when we have the legal, comment on dit ça, le jugement, the judging of the Airbus against Boeing file. As it is, I did write several times to the commissioner in charge of agriculture and trade, and he has just answered saying that he was optimistic. So I don't know what to be optimistic means, but he's the man in charge, so maybe that means that some things are changing. It is true that with the COVID-19, the plain market is not the same. Huh? And so the big issue that Donald Trump has to face and that Europe has to face, but in a lesser extent, is Boeing going bust, which is maybe if Boeing goes bust, then we don't have any more taxes problem.
So Felicity, in terms of what you're hearing and what you're seeing, what do you think are the issues that people from the outside or inside, because you're based in Germany, but you're hearing stuff from anywhere. Are there any issues that we're not talking about that people are thinking about in terms of Europe?
I think there's a long-term underlying issue which I don't think has had nearly enough attention, which is the demographic changes. We're seeing, this isn't just Europe, but it's striking Europe the hardest. We're seeing a lot of people aging out of being vignerons and property owners, and their children don't want to take it over because it's just not high margin enough. So I think in the it's begun to happen, but within the next 10 years, we're going to see a really great wave of consolidation across the industry, and we might actually see some properties being abandoned. And I think that the less profitable areas are at most at risk. So some parts of Languedoc-Roussillon, nobody is ever going to lose money on properties in Burgundy and Barolo, but there are some marginal areas where people are really worried about the loss of vignerons, and there hasn't been enough effort to keep young people on the land and to keep them interested, and that is a very, very serious issue that really has to be addressed.
Isn't this already happening? My understanding is that there are two houses specifically that are going through and buying up properties as the older generation passes, and it has to do with the issues of inheritance tax. And then by doing it, they're paying premium dollar. They're paying more than those properties are worth, because they know that that will continue to drive up the value of the swaths that they bought prior to.
There's a huge amount of consolidation going on because interest rates are really low. So at the moment, money is free basically. So if you're a big company and you're cashed up, you can do it. But there's a lot of companies, particularly France is a really good example of this, where they're relying on contract grape growers in places like Languedoc. And the head of one of the big houses said to me, what are we going to do? We're going to buy up the whole Languedoc? We can't. We need the grape supply, but the heirs don't want to take it over. So this is a serious problem in places like the Rhone Valley as well. You can buy up a lot of it, but the other issue that's going to come and is already starting to bite labor issue. People don't want their kids growing up being grape growers. There's much more opportunity. I mean, thankfully, it's good. There's a lot more opportunity now. People who were from Eastern Europe who could be relied on to come and pick grapes, you know, their kids have a lot more opportunities to do other things. So the people who pick grapes are aging out as well. And there's going to have to be a move towards mechanization. That's going to be really difficult because a lot of people don't like the idea of it. There's a lot of really steep slopes that can't be picked that way. So those are the two issues I think that are underlying issues that really haven't been discussed very much.
I just want to say one more thing about that. Forgive me. Doesn't a lot of that come back to issues of pricing? I mean, you know, we have had problems with our margins for so long. And so it is not enticing to younger people because they look at it and they can, you know, diaspora to the city where they can make great money in tech or whatever they're doing. And we don't have the money to pay more for our growers. We don't have the money to mechanize. We don't have the money to try and to risk and to evolve.
Yeah, it's really interesting. The finances is a really interesting issue because right across the world, with the exception of some new world, there's been an enormous resistance to seeing wine as a business. And particularly in parts of Europe, there's even a pushback against the idea of being mercantile and being profitable and making money. And what we've got is we've got an industry that's really a three-tier industry. At one end, you've got almost poverty. You've got people who they own the land, they can live on it, but they're not having any capital investment. They're not being able to buy new equipment. They're not being able to replant. They're not being able to sort of even pay decent salaries. And at the top end, you've got a lot of people who are trophy wineries. You know, and this is a real problem. You've got people who don't demand that their wineries be profitable because it's not their real form of income and they can always put in money from elsewhere. And there's a lot of places in places like Italy would be a really good example where you've got people who've come in and they may not be profitable for another 15 years. And in the middle, you've got people who are squeezed by those two people who are trying to make money, but the market has been trained by these other people that it doesn't have to pay high prices for a product. So there's a very serious underlying pricing issue with wine. So there's that. And some of that's only going to be sorted out when people start to leave the land because they can't afford it. And when that happens, the prices of wine might adjust.
So Felicity, Irene, you have worked in a privately owned company in the sense of Scali, a cooperative in the sense of Val d'Orbieu, now with your own small estate, and now you're looking at it from a European. How do you react to some of the things that Felicity has been talking about there?
Felicity was bang on. I must admit that the aging is not only on the wine, it's on the farmers. And we are facing a catastrophe because farmers do not earn a good enough income. And so, of course, children who see their parents having money problems all their life, they don't want to do that job. But in the wine, for instance, in the Pic Saint-Loup, they have managed to have a quality of life with the income that makes it nice, and so the young they want to take over. And so in Pic Saint-Loup, all the estates, the children they take over from their parents. So when the going is good, then it works. So basically, we have to work on the income. We also have to be, because of the generation problem, what the aging and the lack of heirs, we need to be forceful in the recruitment of young guys that would like to become winemakers. So it means that those who are doing winemaking studies make sure that we take their hand and accompany them so that they can put their hand on soil. That also means that in the European Union, we have just voted some very big budgets to protect the European Union against the buying of land by foreign states or foreign companies. because that exists and it can be very big. But then if we do not own the land, we will never manage to put young farmers on them or young winemakers. So I think with the new technology, the satellites, with Zoom, and we can maybe make our policies more effective because we target, we have Erasmus and we can exchange and make sure that the young guys, I mean, for instance, a guy from Poland, maybe he would never dream of becoming a winemaker, but maybe through Erasmus, he will fall in love with Corbière, and maybe he will want to become a winemaker in Corbière. And I think that the consistency of the European policies is making sure that if this guy exists, he can become a young winemaker in Corbière. And making European subsidies a lot more simple and accessible.
So Irène, where you are, Pic Saint-Loup is quite a small appellation.
Yeah.
And you can sell your wine for 10 hectares, but I think that your neighbors may be a bit cheaper. But I probably won't find a wine in Pic Saint-Loup for much less than 5, 6, 7 for example. Now, if I cross the road and I go a little further, I go into Minervois, I go to Corbière, the big appellation, I can buy their wine that maybe costs them the same to produce as your wine, and I can buy that for €2. And I can buy that for maybe even in bulk, I can buy it for €1.50 or whatever. So to me, that raises some very big questions of appellations. Do they work, really? And in the future, yes, for a young man, as you've just said, a young man or woman may well want to come and make wine in the next door vineyard to you because they can see being able to live from it. How are we going to make it attractive for those young people to go into areas like the ones we're talking about, where it's very hard to see a price, than being able to get a price for the wine, because they're relying on that brand of the appellation brand that has a low perceived value?
The perception, I think the value perception of an AOC, if it's a smaller appellation, we can find solution. If it's a big thing like Bordeaux, it's more complicated. Look at Mont-Louis. Mont-Louis was nothing. And then you had Jackie Blow that came. And there a first group or 3-4 vignerons started saying, oh, we should do a semi-sweet chemin. And they did a fantastic semi-sweet chemin. And now Mont-Louis is going well. So I think that's exactly what happened in Pic Saint-Loup. So if you have an appellation that has a size of 5,000 hectares, which means something between 100 and 150,000 hectoliters, you can have a name that is sufficiently big to create consumer awareness, but at the same time have a crowd of winemakers that is sufficiently small so that you can have a common way of behaving in terms of quality choices and sales marketing choices. But for very big AOCs, I must admit, I don't know what is the future of Corbière. I don't know.
Felicity.
There's a couple of parts to this. One is actually financial literacy. One of the organizations, and I won't name them because I can't remember exactly which one it was, but it's one of the big Languedoc appellations. One of the regional bodies actually went in and costed everybody's cost of production, and they realized that a lot of people were selling at €2 ex cellar, and the minimum they should have been doing was €3 ex cellar. That the people weren't actually costing their own production effectively. And once they did that, and they said to everyone, look, you can't afford to sell your wines for this much, it improved the overall regional profitability. Now, there are actually a couple of examples. One is the Rhone, and the other is Wines of Austria, where they have got everybody collectively together and said, we want to get out of the bulk wine market. And they've actually said, this is what it's going to cost, and you're going to be having some pain because the supermarkets want that bulk wine. But if we can all hold the line together and agree that we will not sell for under this certain amount, we'll all be more profitable. In fact, if you look at Austria, since they made that decision, you know, the per litre price in Austria is just going up and up and up. So they made a decision that they weren't going to be selling at the low end anymore, and it's worked for them.
Yeah, it's the same that happened in Provence, and it's the same that happened in Pic Saint-Loup, but in Corbière and Bordeaux, I do not see it coming, but maybe one day, but it's difficult. I don't know, except from, because in Austria or in Provence, in the Rhône, there is always one guy that starts and that convinces his neighbors. And AOC basically is that. It's a common rule that a group of men decides to apply to themselves to create value at a majority. It's not unanimity, it's democracy. So, for instance, in the Pic Saint-Loup, they decided that it was mainly Syrah. And you always have Pic Saint-Loup growers that say, oh, I would prefer it to be Grenache. But the value of the Pic Saint-Loup was built on Syrah. And if they had not made this choice, then Pic Saint-Loup would never have been able to grow because it would not have been clear in terms of taste, in terms of price, in terms of vineyard look, and so on. So I have seen it happening, but I don't know in places where you don't have demand, because in Corbière, they have Gérard Bertrand. So Gérard is a fantastic guy, but I have not seen the situation in the Corbière changing.
And so when we actually look at this, we already have hundreds of French appellations. We have whatever it is, nearly 400 or whatever appellations. But if we begin to say, so you have like 4,500, 5,000 hectares in Pic Saint-Loup, yes. If we look at Corbière, we look at Minervois, we're talking about 14, 15,000 hectares. If we start breaking them down into smaller areas, which is kind of what you're talking about, we'll end up with France being like Italy, just hundreds and hundreds of more small areas. Does that make sense? Will that work? Can each of those really maintain, create an identity for itself?
They can create an identity for themselves if they are linked with a tourism strategy. And this works very well. I would like to come back on the Italian case because I think the Italians have been geniuses in building a common image with a complexity behind. But when you drink Italian wines, they always talk about the Dolce Vita. And they have relied on the pizzerias and all the Italian restaurants all over the world. And all this image is consistent. In France, it's more complicated. We are not able to make a consistent way. Say it in another way. I have never been struck at our capacity at having consistent French wines campaign that encompasses all the categories of wines France is producing. At cheese, we managed to do it. In wine, I don't know why. We always have Bordeaux competing with the Rhône, and it's even in the Languedoc, we cannot manage to have a Sud de France campaign, and it's complicated. I don't know why.
Felicity, you've looked at the issue of tourism, wine tourism, over the years. What's your outside vision of that in terms of the future?
Oh, well, you know, what a question.
Well, COVID, obviously the COVID-19 raises some questions, and climate change raises questions.
Look, wine tourism was one of the great, and I say past tense, was one of the greatest things that has happened to the wine industry. Over the past 5 years, it's added tremendous value to wine in every direction. It's been a two-way street where people have opened their doors to the world, and in so doing, they've had to learn a lot of new skills and modernize very quickly. It's been an absolutely fantastic thing. Now, I say was, because we have no idea what happens next. And the other thing is we don't even know if we want it to come back. You know, everybody's thinking about climate change and about what mass travel really, really means. And I think we're going to have to approach travel in a much more leisurely and thoughtful way than we have in the past. But I completely agree with what Irene is saying. I think complexity is not a problem. And it's definitely not a problem if it's tied to tourism, because everybody wants discovery. But complexity that doesn't have interest behind it is the problem. You know, if it's just bland and boring, then there's no reason to engage with it or remember it. And unfortunately, there's too much wine, particularly from Mediterranean regions, that's bland and boring. They haven't managed to make a reason for people to remember it. I'm not saying the wines themselves are bland and boring. I'm just saying people haven't given a reason for it to be memorable.
Irene?
So earlier on, I talked about the fundings I did with EU money and the biodiversity auto-diagnostic for the farmers and growers. And in fact, I have a few wine growers that changed their marketing way of presenting their wine because of that. Because they started having bat houses and explaining the link between, here you are in a preserved environment. And so the tourist needs a narrative, a history that is local and that is funded on local realities. Like if you go to Picpoul de Pinay, the grape can mature because of the sea salt and things like that. And then the guys, they will go back with their white Picpoul and say, oh, this wine is very good with oysters, and it's the only vineyards that are so close to the Mediterranean Sea. And I think it's important for the, as Felicity was saying, we really need to have a qualitative and unique story behind the wine tourist. But it can be done at the local size. And yes, this is where AOC or EGP or GIs can help.
So now I've got one question before we, because we're nearly coming up to time, but there is one thing that when we talk about, and I had a conversation with Eric Asimov, the New York Times writer, and we talked about industrial wine, and his vision of industrial wine is not necessarily one that he sees in Europe. He sees very big, the Gallo type wineries in the States. But when we see Europe, we don't necessarily have those, but we have huge cooperatives. And the cooperatives are still 50% of the European wine, I would say, roughly, and or more, in depending on the level. In one sense, they are the strength, because they are the size, they've got all the growers and so on. On the other hand, and they're much better than they were, but on the other hand, they are a weakness, because they've lacked a dynamism of brand building, they've lacked all sorts of levels of dynamism. What we don't have in Europe, which you have in Australia and in the New World generally, is people who just grow grapes. So when your husband was working for Scali, I remember he had to go around visiting all these little people who made wine and delivered wine to Scali that he then had to blend together, sometimes dealing with some of the problems that have been created in those wineries. If he was a Gallo, he would just be bringing in the grapes from everywhere and making wine. Do you see an evolution happening in the way wine is produced in Europe from where it is today?
Not really. Me, I don't think. I wonder if we were... some guys are buying grapes. I think you have the Champagne area that is very specific. You have some négociants that are very specific. But I have not seen a massification or a turn from buying wines from négociants to buying grapes. No.
But do you think the cooperatives will become more dynamic in Europe? Because if they do, they are going to provide more of a more competition to the New World than we've seen before.
Frankly speaking, I wish, but I'm not sure, because I mean, yesterday night I was at a dinner with all the French cooperatives, and all the big guys were there, and they are lovely people, and they are lovely people, but I'm not sure they work together. It's my cup, your cup, and then they will exchange, but I don't know why. It's a cooperative in their power their market power is lost to syndicalism power, if you see what I mean. I mean, they're always, okay, when we need European money, they are the first one to ask for it and to negotiate. And they really like politics. I don't think they like markets.
Can I jump in on that? We have seen some, so I have to declare an interest. We have some cooperatives that advertise with the magazine. And I'm not saying this because of this, but there are some French cooperatives that are fantastically, innovative. And I think Celia Dauphin would be one. There's a couple of Italians. You know, in another way, I've been talking all evening about the problem of demographics and age and whatever. I actually think some of the cooperative problems are going to be solved because there's going to be a change of management happening soon. Some of the cooperative people I've met are just really, they do things because that's the way they've been doing things for years and years and years. But I think there's another generation that might be a lot more dynamic coming.
Well, I have to declare an interest as well, because we produce Le Grand Noir with a set of cooperatives not a very long drive away from Irène, Célie and Jean Dalibert. And we've been working with them for, 15 years, and they're not as young as they were 15 years ago, but they're still quite young in mind. And I think you're absolutely right, Felicity, there will be a new generation. So I'm slightly more optimistic maybe than Irène was there. But let's finish on, you are literally just coming up to the last minutes. Irène, you've been in the European Parliament now for a year. How long have you got to go before you have to stand for election again?
5 years.
So what do you, in 5 years' time, you may or may not want to stand again, but what do you want at the end of this period to say that you have achieved as an MEP and that you think Europe has achieved? What will you feel that you to justify the effort and the passion that you've put into it and others have put into it?
Also, I am very dedicated on changing the CAP policy to a food policy and food and wine policy. So this is like a Loch Ness history, but I think we can manage to do something that is more localized. So that's something around getting out of Tableur Excel and discussions that are very abstract on big budget on the CIP, and making all the European citizens proud of on the fact that the tomato they are eating, the pasta they are eating, the cookies they are eating, the ham, the wine they are drinking, the beer, the spirit, all are part of a European food scheme that also explains our environment and helps us keep us in a better health and also in a better environment. So I'm very targeted on these issues. I would like, and also I must admit that Brexit for me was a really populist countries, and we have fake news and things like that, and the result can be the end of the European project. So me, I am also here because I want the European citizens to realize that some good things in their life are from the European project. So to give you an example, in the recovery plan, we have the Just Transition Fund that starts on the 1st of January. And that is to help for energy to go out of coal and into renewable energies. And with some colleagues, we have fought to fund mobility, like hydrogen buses and trams, electric mobility. And just for the French market, in the next 3 years, with the Just Transition Fund, we will have 2 billion euros to fund hydrogen buses and trams. And I think that these, all the French guys that will benefit from the European policy Just Transition Fund, then they will have an increase of their, they will have more money because they will need their car less. They will live in an environment with less circulation of cars. And I'm sure that I want to make sure that they realize that this comes from the concrete application of European policy, and that there is no more Brexit possible.
So you've made me very happy in one sense for you. at the moment, Polly is sitting in Spain. She's in Europe. Felicity is sitting in Germany. She's in Europe. You are sitting in the beautiful part of Languedoc. You're in Europe and I'm in Britain and I'm no longer in Europe. And I'm going to go away and cry. But anyway, thank you for this very, very positive view, and thank you for your time. It's been fascinating, and I'd love to come back and we'll discuss more European stories in a future date. But thank you very much, Irene. And
thank you very much, Robert.
Thank you, Felicity.
Thank you, Felicity.
Polly, as ever.
Thank you, Polly.
Thank you. Stay safe.